now we go into the ABL depth and structure topic, but still under the mean boundary layer characteristics. Just now we talked about the characteristics of turbulence and what generates turbulence. Here we talk about the structure of the atmospheric boundary layer, the different layers of the atmospheric boundary layer, and the depths of each of the sublayers of the atmospheric boundary layer. So, over land surfaces in high-pressure regions, the boundary layer has a well-defined structure that evolves with the diurnal cycle. So, when you say well-defined structure, is that we'll be able to separate or we'll be able to distinguish the different layers inside the ABL quite well. And it changes with the diurnal cycle, just like what we saw before. Now, the three major components of this structure are the mixed layer, the residual layer, and the stable boundary layer. So where does all this layer come in within the atmospheric boundary layer? So we see here the mixed layer, the residual layer, and the stable boundary layer. The y-axis is the height in kilometers. The x-axis is time. The free atmosphere is above that. So looking at time, this is noon, sunset, midnight, sunrise, and noon. So this is for 24 hours. From noon to noon, and we see the changes the atmosphere undergoes, the atmospheric boundary layer undergoes with time. So starting from noon, there is a surface layer, somewhere about 10% of this layer. And then above this surface layer is the convective mixed layer, and the ABL consists mostly of the convective mixed layer above the surface layer. Then we go to sunset. When the sun sets, then of course the amount of heat that is absorbed by the ground becomes lower because there's less solar radiation. There's still the surface layer there, but then this convective mixed layer is replaced by the stable boundary layer, which increases at night to increase in height. But above this stable boundary layer is residual layer. So this residual layer is a layer that is left over from the daytime convective mixed layer. And then this stable boundary layer starts to grow until sunrise. It goes up, it encroaches on the residual layer more, but when it reaches the day, when the surface starts to be heated up again, then suddenly this stable boundary layer decreases in height. Surface layer increase in height. Notice this surface layer is high during the day, then lowers in the night, and then increase again. And then this stable boundary layer is separate, becomes the mixed layer. Convective mixed layer again, and the cycle continues. So the three main layers. First, surface layer, convective mixed layer. At night, surface layer. Then the stable boundary layer above the surface layer. Then above the stable boundary layer, the residual layer. Residual layer, something like convective mixed layer. This is a combination of stable boundary layer and convective mixed layer. And then it changes back to mixed layer, and the cycle continues on a daily basis. So above this, you see the entrainment zone, and then the capping zone and the free atmosphere. So the few things to note is the height of these different layers. So what we experience on the surface of the Earth is basically the surface layer. Because if you want to experience the convective mixed layer or the stable boundary layer and the mixed layer, this mixed layer and this one is basically the same. You have to go about 200 to 300 meters above the ground. Then only you can see these changes. But if you are within the surface layer most of the time, that's why you don't see that marked change. Because it's still within the surface layer. But then at night, if you go a bit higher, then you can experience a stable boundary layer where there's less mixing compared to the convective mixed layer. So the difference between this convective mixed layer and stable boundary layer is the degree of turbulence. In the mixed layer, we have a lot of vertical motion. Stable boundary layer has less vertical motion, less turbulence during the stable boundary layer. The bottom 10% of the boundary layer is called the surface layer, regardless of whether it is part of a mixed layer or a stable boundary layer. So this is on top of the 10% that I talked about for the atmospheric boundary layer and the troposphere. Remember, there's a 10% atmospheric boundary layer and then there's a troposphere. But then within that atmospheric boundary layer, there's a surface layer. It's also 10% of the atmospheric boundary layer. Now we go into the mixed layer, somewhere above the surface layer. The turbulence in the mixed layer is usually convective driven. That means it is controlled by convective processes or the vertical motion of the atmosphere due to the surface forcing. Although a nearly well mixed layer can form in regions of strong winds. So the major convective source is the heat transfer from the warm ground surface. But then keep in mind that this mixed layer is not exactly next to the surface. Next to the surface is the surface layer. Slightly above the surface layer is where this mixed layer resides. So this mixed layer growth is tied to solar heating of the ground. A turbulent mixed layer begins to grow in depth about a half hour after sunrise. So it doesn't take that much of time. Once the sun starts to heat up, starts to rise, it heats up the surface. About half an hour, then you start to see it develop. This mixed layer develop above the surface layer. So about, let's say the sunrise is about 7 o'clock, then 7:30, we start to see the formation of mixed layer above the surface layer. So the mixed layer reaches its maximum depth in the late afternoon. So the late afternoon is about 2-3 p.m. That's the maximum height of this mixed layer. The resulting turbulence tends to mix heat, moisture, and momentum uniformly in the vertical. Once there's a mixed layer, then the concentration of gases in this, or the concentration of moisture, concentration of heat in this mixed layer becomes well mixed. So if you sample one position in the mixed layer, one vertical position, that sample should represent the entire mixed layer because it's well mixed. This is in contrast to stable boundary layer. If it's stable, if you measure at one, the concentration will be different from another layer and another layer. There's a trend in the stable boundary layer because it doesn't mix. But in the mixed layer, it's all mixed, right? So you get the same concentration for every vertical point in the mixed layer. So pollutants emitted from smokestacks exhibit a characteristic looping as those portions of the effluent emitted into warm thermals begin to rise. Looping means going up and down. When there's a lot of mixture, there's a lot of mixing processes in that layer. And if it's in the stable layer, then it's found on top of the mixing layer, acting as a lid to the rising thermals. So let's say there is a surface layer, and there's a mixed layer, and there's a stable boundary layer here. So if it's somewhere within this convective mixed layer, then there is looping vertical motion up and down. But then if there is a stable boundary layer above that, then this stable boundary layer would stop the spread of this vertical into the upper atmosphere. It acts as a cap to the mixing. So pollutant concentrations can build up in the mixed layer, while in the free atmosphere, concentrations remain relatively low because of the capping. So if there is continuous emission into this mixed layer, it will be well mixed, and then it will be accumulated into this layer because of this constant emission. And then there's a stable boundary layer on top. It stops it from moving upwards, so then the concentrations start to increase if there's a continuous emission of these gases or pollutants. So pollutants are transported by eddies such as thermals. You've seen this before. Therefore, the inability of thermals to penetrate very far into the stable layer means that the stable layer acts as a lid to the pollutant. So thermals would cause this looping, but then if there's a stable boundary layer at the top, the average mixed layer at the top, this stable condition above this layer here would stop, would act as a cap to this looping. And then if this continues to be released into the atmosphere, then it starts to increase in concentration within this mixed layer. Now, residual layer. About half hour before sunset, that means close to nighttime, the thermals cease to form because the sun is about to set, allowing turbulence to decay. You saw the decay of turbulence. You have large eddies and then starts to decrease in size, dissipate in the formerly well-mixed layer. So the resulting layer of air is sometimes called the residual layer. There are other terms too. Residual means something like leftover layer. For some ways, mixed layer, then it starts to decrease. The thermals start to decrease and becomes the residual layer. Because its initial mean state variables and concentration variables are the same as those of the recently decayed mixed layer. So it's not exactly a mixed layer, but it's a leftover of the mixed layer, and we call it the residual layer. But still, the residual layer is a well-mixed layer, but not as strong as the mixed layer. So in the absence of advection, so advection is horizontal transport. So far, we've all been only talking about vertical transport, not horizontal transport. So let's say if we assume that advection is not there, then passive traces, such as air pollutants, you know what traces are? Traces are something you put in the, like say a trace gas, you put it in the atmosphere, and then we can trace the gas as it moves through the atmosphere. And what it means by passive means that it doesn't react, doesn't change in form, doesn't chemically react in the atmosphere to be destroyed or change to something else. So if you put a tracer in the atmosphere inside this residual layer, and then without this move vertical transport, without this horizontal transport, it is dispersed into the daytime mixed layer, will remain aloft in the residual layer during the night. That means it will go in the residual layer, and then it will stay in the residual layer in the night, during the night. The residual layer is neutrally stratified, resulting in turbulence that is nearly of equal intensity in all directions. So when it goes up, it will maintain inside that layer. It doesn't change anywhere else. It will stay within the residual layer. And then it would... the turbulence within the neutrally stratified layer is about the same throughout. So as a result, smoke plumes emitted into the residual layer tend to disperse at equal rates in the vertical and lateral directions, creating a cone-shaped plume. If it's emitted into this residual layer here, neutrally stratified layer. So each day, more moisture may be evaporated into the mixed layer and will be retained in the residual layer, and then will be entrained, go back down into the mixed layer during the next morning. So, every day, evaporation, solar heating would heat up the ground, it will evaporate some of the moisture, it goes into the mixed layer, and then during the night, there's no more solar radiation, there's no more evaporation, and then it will be maintained within the residual layer, and then during the mixed layer, it starts to be pulled back down. So there is an accumulation of this moisture in the atmosphere. You go into the residual layer, come back to the mixed layer, then go into the residual layer and come back to the mixed layer. The residual layer potential temperature profile remains nearly adiabatic. So the residual layer does not have direct contact with the ground. Yeah, I think you've seen this one. You have the surface layer, the mixed layer. Sometimes the mixed layer can be very strong. It can go down to the ground. But if, and then at night, it starts to decrease mixed layer and it becomes a residual layer. So this residual layer is always above. But during the day, it becomes mixed layer, and at night, it becomes residual layer, and mixed layer, and so on. Now the stable boundary layer, and this is just for night. As the night progresses, the bottom portion of the residual layer is transformed by its contact with the ground into a stable boundary layer. So this is characterized by statically stable air with weaker sporadic turbulence. The wind at ground level frequently becomes lighter or calm at night. And the characteristic of this stable boundary layer is that there's less turbulence, and if there is a pollution, if there's air pollutants being dispersed into the stable boundary layer, it doesn't disperse well. It will be concentrated at a certain layer. And it will be, if there is a horizontal wind, it will carry that concentrated gas further away. So the statically stable air in this layer tends to suppress turbulence. It doesn't remove turbulence entirely, it just reduces turbulence. And by suppressing it, we see turbulence if it's hot and it starts to rise, but then this condition, this stable condition, actually stops it from rising. Okay, that's what it means by suppress, but there's still turbulence, very small amounts. So pollutants emitted into the stable layer disperse relatively little in the vertical, although it could move horizontal, but it doesn't disperse vertically. They disperse more rapidly or fan out in the horizontal. This behavior is called fanning. So, although the wind at ground level frequently becomes lighter or calm at night, the winds aloft may accelerate to super geostrophic speeds in a phenomenon that is called the low-level jet or nocturnal jet. One characteristic of stable layer is, one thing of course, it's the turbulence is low, but then it's very stratified. Okay, be familiar with this word, stratified. Stratified means that there are many layers, and the layers are distinct. I mean, like a layer cake, you know, you see the different layers. So in a stable atmosphere, the layers are very distinct. So at the ground, it might be low wind speeds, like what we usually experience on the ground, but somewhere above, totally different situation, where the wind speeds could be very large. But doesn't mean that the wind speed is, that doesn't mean that the turbulence is large. It just means that mean winds are strong. So that is what I mean by this low-level jet or nocturnal jet, higher above the ground. So So touching the ground, however, is a thin layer, a few meters of katabatic or drainage winds. These winds are caused by the colder air adjacent to the ground flowing downhill under the influence of gravity. So this is specifically for areas that are next to the mountains or hills called the katabatic winds or drainage winds. So then we go to the thermal stability.